Grace, mercy, and peace be yours in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Tonight's message is based off of our reading out of Judges. I'll read just Judges 13:24. And the woman bore a son and called his name Samson, and the young man grew, and the Lord blessed him. Here ends the reading of our text. May God add his blessings to the reading of his word. Amen. Tonight's story comes from the book of Judges, another Old Testament book that barely gets used in our pericope system. In fact, the only day we have a reading from Judges is the Festival of St. Thomas, which falls on December 21st. If the 21st happens to fall on a Sunday, then the churches have a choice between either the readings for the fourth Sunday of Advent or the Festival of St. Thomas. However, if the pastor actually chooses to use the readings for the Festival of St. Thomas, the reading out of Judges, what you get is the story of Gideon using the fleece to try to confirm that Jesus is actually speaking to him and giving him those directions. And that is not our story tonight. Tonight we are searching the scriptures in reference to Samson. As we do, we remember the words of our Lord that he spoke to some Pharisees one day. He said, "You search the scriptures because you think in them you have eternal life, and it is they that bear witness about me. Yet you refuse to come to me that you may have life." Tonight, we will not make the same mistake that those Pharisees made. We will find Jesus. Samson's story is in Judges chapters 13 through 16. And if you want to look at it in your pew Bible as we go along, it begins on page 221. As you read the story, or as you remember it from your Sunday school days, it is easy to see that Samson was a flawed man, to say the least. That, however, is our first connection to Jesus. Sometimes we might feel that we're not good enough to serve Jesus, to be his representative. We somehow feel like we need to be nearly sinless, some sort of super saint that walk around with a glow about us, like in the pictures that artists make. We may feel that because we are tempted by the weakness of our fallen flesh, we can't serve. But Samson was a weak man, and still the Lord used him in mighty ways. It reminds me of the words of St. Paul, who said, "But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, even things that are not, to bring to nothing things that are, so that no human being might boast in the presence of God." Samson was a Nazarite from his birth, drinking no wine or strong drink, eating nothing unclean, never having his hair cut. Like Jesus, he was dedicated for a mission before birth. That mission, the mission of Samson, was to save the people of God. Samson actually did that in part. But Jesus, who also had the mission to save the people of God, did so completely and fully. Unlike Jesus, as I've said, Samson was flawed, ultimately breaking every aspect of his Nazarite vow. So Jesus then is the greater Samson, for he was completely obedient to his calling, achieving salvation, a salvation that Samson could never have achieved. We will have to let that stand as our only real comments about Samson's many flaws. Read the story cover to cover there, or chapter to chapter, if you want to pick up on more. But in his failures and his flaws, He then becomes a type of humanity and reminds us, oh, how's that hymn put it? We are weak, but he is strong. Next, we notice the special circumstances surrounding Samson's birth. His mother was unable to bear children. We are actually told this twice in chapter 13, just to emphasize the point. In verse 2, we read, she was barren and had no children. And then it is repeated in verse 3 as well, when Jesus appears to her and promises her a child. Such a combination, a woman that is childless and then receiving a divine announcement that a son shall be born to her, marks a special child in the Old Testament. We have it with Sarah, the wife of Abraham, who would become the mother of Isaac and carry on the promise. And Hannah, who became the mother of the great prophet Samuel, and then the mother of Samson. In the New Testament, we also have the example of Elizabeth, the mother of John the Baptist. In each of these cases, we see the virgin birth of our Lord foreshadowed as the angel appeared to Mary, a virgin who obviously, therefore, was not conceiving any children, with the good news of her miracle baby. Samson was to be a judge. Now, when we think of a judge, we think of somebody sitting at a bench with a gavel announcing either you're innocent or you're guilty or something like that. A court of law image. That was not the main role of an Old Testament judge. They were military leaders. You can see that plainly by considering the other judges like Gideon or Deborah. They all marshaled armies to fight Israel's battles, to fight the enemies of God's people. In this, the judge represents Jesus, who is called so often in the Old Testament the Lord of hosts, or if you want to sound a little bit more Hebrew-y, the Lord of Sabaoth. That's the word in the Sanctus that I used to always get confused when I was a kid with the word Sabbath. I thought we're just sort of being artsy-fartsy there, you know, and trying to sound smart. But it's really a different word. It's the Lord of hosts or the Lord of armies. And it is referring to Jesus as our warrior God who defeats our eternal foes. He is our almighty captain. He is the greater judge. Samson, though, is the only Old Testament judge that did not have an army to back him. All the other ones had armies. So when he faced God's enemies, the enemies of God's people, he did it mano a crowd. Okay? Man against army, so to speak. And in this we have, again, another message about Jesus. First, as indicated, it is the case with all of the judges, Samson represented our Lord as he faces Satan defeating him. The vocation of Old Testament judge points us toward not only the general ministry of Jesus where he defeats the devil, you know, by casting out demons and that sort of stuff, but especially the cross, because that is where Jesus' battle with Satan reached its climax. Next, because Samson faced the enemies of God's people alone, Samson also foreshadowed the cross where Jesus faced our ancient foes alone. The work of our salvation is shared by no one. We have no co-saviors. We also read in chapter 16 about Samson's death. He had been abandoned by his countrymen, yet in his death he achieved his greatest victory. So it is with Jesus. Yes, Jesus defeated Satan, like I said, when he was casting out demons and whatnot. But in his death on the cross, he achieved the greatest victory of all time, destroying the power of Satan and freeing us from the dominion of sin, death, and the devil. So Samson's victorious death foreshadowed Jesus's victorious death. We quickly turn to the birth of Samson again. The divine person that appeared to Samson's parents was Jesus. We see that from two specific items in the story, along with the words of 1 Timothy, where we are told that there is one God and one mediator between God and man, the man Jesus Christ. The first indicator in the story is that Jesus is called the angel of the Lord, or more literally, the angel of Yahweh. And that is done multiple times. But finally, this very special visitor from heaven is simply identified as God, in case you missed it before. The angel of the Lord is Jesus. Then Samson's father asks Jesus for his name, and the Lord responds, "Why do you ask my name, seeing as it is wonderful?" That kind of makes you think of Isaiah, where he said, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." And now I'm going to go home and put on the Messiah. Let's now consider some of the events in his life. During the time of Samson, the people of Israel were subjugated by a foreign power. It was the Philistines. During Jesus' day, the people of Israel were subjugated by a foreign power. It was Rome. In chapter 15, Samson was betrayed by his fellow countrymen and turned over to the power of the enemies of God. So Jesus was betrayed by his fellow countrymen and turned over to the Romans. One of the well-known stories of Samson is when he was attacked by a lion. Samson battles the lion and kills it, actually tearing it in two. The text says, "As one tears a young goat." The image is of a goat that is being pulled apart to be eaten by those who are standing around waiting to eat it. And we might think in terms of like a Thanksgiving turkey and pulling the leg off the turkey to eat it, or wing, or whatever you want, you know. Later, as Samson traveled by the same way, he went to see the lion and discovered some bees had made a hive in the dead animal. Samson scooped out some of the honey to eat, even giving some of it to his parents, who were unaware of where the honey came from. Now that's important because Samson's parents are good people. Remember that Samson is a Nazarite. He's not supposed to touch anything unclean. And a corpse is, by any way you look at it, unclean. So mom and dad didn't know where they were getting the honey from, and Samson didn't care. It was just another example of how he was weak, okay? Anyway, later, Samson composed a riddle out of the event. Out of the eater came something to eat. Out of the strong came something sweet. This is all found in chapter 14, by the way. While there are many shadows of Christ in this chapter, we have time to consider just one. Now, the lion can be thought of as representing Jesus, as some of the early church fathers actually do, especially because something sweet comes from its death. However, in this case, I like to think of passages like 1 Peter 5:8. "Be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour." And that lion certainly tried to devour Samson. Our greater Samson, Jesus, meets that roaring lion, the devil, and utterly defeats him. In that defeat, we find something very sweet: our salvation, eternal life, peace between God and his children. It reminds me of when Jesus was casting out demons one day. When questioned about it, he explained how he achieved this with a short parable where a strong man is defending his possessions, and then a stronger man comes and binds the first man and plunders the bound man's possessions. The strong man is Satan, and the stronger man is Jesus. With the lion, we have the strong man, and with Samson, we have the stronger man. That is Jesus. What would a sermon themed about Samson be if we didn't touch on his doomed love of Delilah? There is nothing in the text, nothing at all, to indicate that Delilah loved Samson. She didn't. In that we see our Lord Jesus depicted. As John 3:16 tells us, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. There are many places in the Bible that reflect this reckless love of God for fallen humanity. You can look at the most fanatical Islamist in the eye and say, Jesus loves you, and you will be right. You can look at the most rabid atheist straight in the eye and say, Jesus loves you, and you will be right. You can look at all of God's human enemies straight in the eye and say, Jesus loves you. Does that mean that they will return the love? Does that mean that they will all come to faith? Sadly for them, it does not. As Jesus once said over the city of Jerusalem, O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how often I would have gathered you together as a hen gathers its chicks under its wings, but you were not willing. One of the shadows of Christ that we see in the story of Samson and Delilah is this reckless love that Jesus has for all people. He loves us, even if we do not return his love, even if we betray his love. Thank the good Lord that such is not the case for us. We have heard his voice and believed in him. When Jesus sought to gather us together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, the Spirit of the Lord saw to it that the effort was not in vain. We have been covered by our Lord's wings of grace. Well, that is all the time we have tonight. May our greater Samson, who has lavished his reckless love upon us, use his might to keep us safe from our adversary. Amen. May the peace of God, which passes human understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.